On Wednesday, at the age of 90, William Shatner became the oldest man to enter into space and float around in the New Shepard space capsule. We'd known him, of course, as Captain Kirk in imaginary space voyages of the USS Enterprise, to explore strange new worlds, to boldly go where no man has gone before. We heard commands like, "Beam me up, Scotty. Maximum warp speed. Set phasers on stun." But that was fantasy, and this was real. Science fiction had become science. Though the flight was only 10 minutes, he made it to the edge of space and floated in weightlessness for about 3 minutes. Back on Earth in West Texas, when he cautiously stepped out of the capsule, he was visibly moved. He said, "I hope I never recover from this. I hope that I can maintain what I feel now, awe and wonder." It was a coup for Jeff Bezos and his Blue Origin Space Company. He was competing with fellow billionaires Richard Branson and his Virgin Galactic, and Elon Musk and SpaceX, which can take people into orbit for $200 million, and will eventually take people to the moon. Why do these billionaires engage in this kind of race? Are they thirsty for more wealth, power, fame? What is at the root of ambition? Is it ego, insecurity, the need for a legacy, the attempt to prove your worthiness to others? Do you remember the name Simone Biles of the U.S.? She made the news because she did not compete in some of her events at the Tokyo Olympics. And as expected, she faced very fierce criticism that she was selfish, childish, and a national embarrassment. At earlier meets, she had completed some routines which were far too dangerous to attempt, even for other top athletes. And she was asked, "Why are you doing this?" She replied, "Because I can." Or here's a Michelangelo lying on his back on a scaffold, painting his masterpieces on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel. His contemporaries judged him to be relentlessly ambitious, a pain in the neck, who thought nothing of crushing artistic rivals to promote his own work. Is ambition good or bad? It is hard to imagine how you could possibly accomplish anything in life without the helpful nudge of ambition. It is the engine that drives so many of our great accomplishments. There are times, though, when ruthless ambition can be deceitful and self-destructive. Consider the unchecked ambition of Shakespeare's Macbeth. The man who would be king kills even his closest friends, who might be a threat to his position. Dangerous ambitions don't need much stoking. Mark, the earliest writer, bluntly records the abrasive story of James and John, asking not so discreetly if they could be the chief ministers of state when Christ enters into his glory. Perhaps the request came quite easily for them and naturally for them. Early in the Gospel, Mark tells us that their father was wealthy enough to employ hired servants. Perhaps they felt entitled. They knew how to order people around. But that naked play for power and position was a source of embarrassment in the early church. That kind of ambition was deemed offensive and unworthy. Matthew, writing 30 years after Mark, when all the disciples were regarded as princes, as holy men of God, says it was the mother of James and John who asked if they could have the top positions in glory. And who can blame a mother for being ambitious for her children? Luke, in his squeamishness, omits the details of this ugly episode and says there was a general discussion about greatness. Jesus said to James and John, "You don't know what you are asking. Are you able to drink from the cup that I drink, or to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" Jesus was asking, "Can you endure the kinds of experiences that I will endure before life is done?" Jesus was thinking about the humiliation, the lashing, and the horrifying suffering of the cross. "Can you be baptized with my kind of baptism?" he asks. The meaning of the verb baptizein in Greek is to submerge. And sometimes we speak of a man who is drowning in debt because it is so overwhelming, or submerged in sorrow, or buried in paperwork because those things are just so great. And Jesus was saying to them, "Are you able to be fully submerged in my kind of world, or to do anything or whatever is necessary to see my kingdom established?" And James and John answered, perhaps in their youthful naivete, "We are able." And we should give them credit for their eagerness and willingness to take on the world. I remember speaking to a classroom full of seminary students. Their eyes were aglow, filled with ambition and a desire to serve and travel to the uttermost parts of the earth, wherever God's Spirit might lead them. They'd heard the call to ministry, and in their ambitious passion had responded, "Here I am, send me." The statistics are that by the time they finish their first year of service in the field, 50% will have left the ministry. I was ambitious too, to make the church tick and hum. At a time when bus ministry was at its height, I was all in. Or to move to a second service, the surest way for growth, when traditions are deep and fast, I was there. Or the introduction of a building project which always generates excitement and commitment. I've been there, done that. And I know this too. Ambition can be the breeding ground for all kinds of other temptations: envy, resentment, selfishness, and vanity. There's no reason not to have ambition and embrace it as a natural partner in our discipleship. But we need to critique our ambition and give it direction. So critical. One of the people I have admired over the years is Maxie Dunham. He's a United Methodist pastor, and for many years the editor of the Upper Room. He's now the president emeritus of Asbury Theological Seminary in Wilmore, Kentucky. As a young man, he was the organizing pastor of a congregation in Mississippi, and under his leadership had known amazing growth and success. And then there was a crisis. The fellowship of the congregation was splintered by his participation in the civil rights movement. He didn't think that was anything radical about his involvement, but many folks in the church could not understand his commitment or his participation. And he could not understand their lack of understanding. The gospel seemed so clear, and the pressure, the stress, the tension wore him out. He was physically, emotionally, and spiritually exhausted, ready to throw in the towel. He felt like he was about to be thrown under the bus. He was torn, rent in two. What was he to do? Maxie Dunham went to a week-long retreat conference at Christian Ashram, led by the famed missionary evangelist E. Stanley Jones. At that retreat, he was led to ask himself the question, who am I? And whose am I? In that struggle, integrity won over fear and effortless fame. It led him to be true to how God was leading him. And he says that was what Dietrich Bonhoeffer was doing in a Nazi prison, which he only left in death. He'd been part of a group of dissenters who had disagreed with the church being so compliant to Hitler. And he helped frame the Barman Declaration as part of the confessing church. They said the church lives by its solid commitment to Jesus Christ alone, not to any earthly power. They would not give in to ultra-nationalism. And doesn't that have reverberations in our time? He was accused of being associated with a plot to assassinate Hitler and sent to the dreaded Gestapo prison in Berlin and finally to Flossenbürg concentration camp, where he was hanged even as the Nazi regime was collapsing. As the end approached, Bonhoeffer was self-reflective. Was he a bold knight of Christian courage that his family and friends and jailers thought him to be? Or was he just the lonely, caged, faint-hearted one that he knew himself to be? He concluded with these lines, "Who am I? They mock me, these lonely questions of mine. Whoever I am, you know, O God, I am yours." In our time, we are nowhere near that kind of life and death issue that Bonhoeffer was facing in his time. But they demand our fresh and courageous stance with every thorny issue that comes before us. Who are we? And whose are we? And in that light, how do we move forward? This is a good time to be asking those questions. Who are we? What does it mean to be the people of God, committed to Jesus Christ? As we emerge from the cocoon of COVID restrictions, as you look to the future and transitions that are coming, as you look at issues of justice and peace with First Nations people and other minorities, or as we care for ourselves and for our neighbors. In that uncomfortable tumult among the 12, in all the Gospels, the answer is the same. It is in service there is greatness.